so much for being here for another EmberConf 2017. You can see this is a really big group, which is really exciting. We have such a vibrant, awesome community. We're back to one track this year, so can you raise your hand who was here last year? All right, I really like one track because it makes us feel like this really awesome community together, and I'm really, really excited to be back.
It also means that all the talks are good for everybody, which is good.
Good point.
So I have some announcements. First of all, you probably are aware that there's a live stream since there was a slide up there about it. You should tell your friends, et cetera. But also probably try not to be a bandwidth hog while you are in attendance. So first of all, probably don't look at the live stream while you're in attendance. That should not be necessary.
Disable your Dropbox.
But second of all, disable your Dropbox and anything else that might be happening just because there's a limited amount of bandwidth you can look around and
sir, you in the front, if you could turn the BitTorrent client off, please.
So there's that. And then the other thing I want to say is just EmberConf has a code of conduct. It's actually important that we follow it, but I just want to give personally how I feel about it. I personally grew up as a Orthodox Jew, which is a religious minority, and I've had a lot of experiences throughout my life where I've been in a room and someone said something that they didn't think that much about, and I just felt like, oh, I really don't want to be in this room anymore. I really wish I could escape this room and be somewhere else. Usually not because someone was on purpose saying something bad, just a situation that I was in. And I think in general, the way I think about code of conduct and being good to your fellow people is if you feel like you're in a situation where that is happening, either as a participant or as a onlooker, if you see somebody who looks very uncomfortable because there's a thing that's going on that probably nobody intended but is causing someone discomfort, try to do something about it. You can be nice, don't necessarily assume that someone's doing something on purpose, but also try to help people feel comfortable in situations. And in terms of the logistics, their website has the full enumeration of it, and if you feel like you need to report something, anybody with a staff shirt, like the red staff shirts, I think. Or are they red this year? I don't know. Green.
Anybody? I guess that means they live.
Anyone with a green staff shirt is around to talk to you. You can also email the email that's on the website. Definitely they are here to help you if there's anything that you need help with. So don't feel shy about enlisting their help in any situation that might require it. Okay. So we are here. This, as Tom said, it's our fifth year here. I was actually preparing a bunch of slides just about the 5 years that we were here, and I thought it was pretty cool that pretty much immediately after we got started, we already had pretty good art. So like the whole five year spectrum has like cool art. So I don't know, how many people remember this blog post? A few people. So the beginning of Ember actually was we were doing SproutCore, and there was a convention that every new project that SproutCore made had a beer name. I don't remember any of them, but it was like Bitburger or something like that. I don't know any beer
Abbott,
names.
Yeah.
So we internally called SproutCore 2 Amber, and then we had talked about that in public a lot, and we were like ready to go ship it. And so we announced ember.js, and people were like, actually, there's a Smalltalk implementation written in JavaScript called ember.js, so you can't have that name. And we had to rename it very quickly over a few days. Which we thought was silly, but whatever, it seems fine. So anyway, this is basically the beginning. This is the birthday, December 8th, 2011, a day that we'll live in. And here is what an Ember app used to look like in the very beginning. This is actually what the Ember 1.10 documentation told you an Ember app was, but some time has gone by since then. But you can see that there was, like, Ember at the time was very much a product of its time. Right, you had a script tag. The way you created handlebars templates is you put them in a script tag, and we didn't yet have a precompiler, so you just, things happened on the fly, et cetera. So we were kind of in our awkward teenage years at the time. By the way, this is not official art, but I looked at them like, this should be an official thing. They should make this cartoon. It would be awesome. It's Fry and Lilo's children. And basically, at the time, there were a lot of things that people, that were very awkward about Ember, like in order to type attributes, you have to use bind adder syntax. And there was this thing, there was like metamorph. I I found a lot of blog posts that I'm very happy I didn't find at the time when I was doing the research for this. So this guy's like, Ember is great, it's so easy to use, but then I looked at the DOM inspector and oh my god, it's like a disaster. So right in the beginning, the way that we dealt with bound properties because of the fact that we had a string templating engine at the time was to use these script tags, which had the nice property of being allowed to be anywhere in the DOM and had the very unnice property of looking terrible in the DOM inspector. there were a bunch of things that we did in the beginning that are like kind of ancient history, probably a lot of people in this room have never seen or heard of them, but were kind of there at the beginning when we started doing Ember. So here, just like a quick whirlwind tour. So 2013 was the first Ember camp ever. We had like camp mascots, and Tavares had this great podcast, Ember on Air, that we made a Tomster for him. And actually the left thing there is the original Tomster illustration just came from, like, we asked Lindsay to do some design work for us. Like, hey, can you make some illustrations for the front page? And the thing that she gave us for productivity was so good that it became the mascot for Ember, which is pretty cool. And like 2014 was basically like we're starting to get into the swing of things. Actually, it's worth noting, 2013, when we did Ember Camp, was like 2 months after that Ember.js announcement, or like 3 months. So we got up and going pretty quickly. And so we, at like 2014, we had another EmberConf. We created the release channel process. We added some features. You can see here, not very important, the details. But we, like, at that point, we didn't yet have the log helper, and we didn't yet have, like, the each helper didn't have that, like, block syntax yet. And we, in 2014, we killed Metamorphs, which I'm still very happy about, and bind adder also. 2015 was basically it's a sugar pirate Tomster, and by 2015, like, oh, we had a lot of user groups, so there, like, that's when we started really getting the Tomster decks, so many Tomsters, and we started, I think 2015 is probably the beginning of when you would consider modern Ember. Like, we started talking about fastboot, we didn't start implementing it really yet. We started working on HTML bars, we talked about Ember 2.0. And just in general, like, the Ember project, including things like Ember CLI, started to be a thing. And there, some more features happened. Like, it actually was hard for me to winnow down the exact list that I snippeted here, but, like, for example, indexes in each loops were a thing that was, like, a highly desired feature before we did it. Thankfully, it is not anymore. Like, now it's just taken for granted, but it was a thing that took us a long time to get right, and, like, the component helper, things like that. And we killed bind adder in 2015, which is great. And we also killed object controller and array controller in 2015, which is also great. And then last year was, we introduced Zoe, which is great. This year we're introducing Zoe as a life-sized mascot you can take pictures with, so you should do that. I would say, like, 2016 was probably the beginning of the era that we were going to be talking about today in the keynote. Trying to get more rationalized about what it is that lives underneath Ember, right? So the first few years of Ember, we were trying to figure out what is an Ember app at all. And last year, we started thinking about, like, what are the building blocks that make up an Ember app, and how can you start reusing them? So app.visit, for example, is an API that lets you build things like fastboot. And not everyone who's doing things like fastboot is using fastboot. They can use the primitive that we built that we put into Ember. And there's things like contextual components. So we started getting more rationalized about what it is that we're doing, and that is really what we're gonna end up talking about today. So we introduced Zoe, we also got Glimmer landed. We started using ES6 features like weak maps if possible. And we also started doing the LTS releases. You can see the lovable LTS mascot, Lumster, on the bottom. So we started doing that. So last year, I would say, is like really we matured as a project. A lot of the things that end up being important about Ember now are what we did last year. And we also killed the render helper, which turned out to not be very important, but had lasted for a long time. So, and so this year, I don't have any photos because we're not here yet. I mean, we're here now.
We are now, yeah, here.
I could not have any photos yesterday for today, but this year, our activity mascot for EmberConf is Tomster and Zoe on a bicycle. It's great. And also this year, user groups are allowed to commission Tomsters. Now they're also allowed to commission Zoes if they want, so they can choose between Tomster and Zoe as their official mascot, which is pretty cool. Before I move on and talk about Ember stuff, I want to talk about a little bit about the core team. There's the usual core team announcement stuff. So this is the core team last year. It's we added some people, but I think last year was a pause more or less in the composition of the team. I think we added Igor last year, I don't remember. It's such a good team. Can't remember. Yeah, I don't remember. After like a few months go by, I'm like an old man.
Yehuda hasn't also slept in 3 days.
I also haven't slept. So this is the team last year. There's a thing that we are going to start doing. Trek, who was one of our early, emeritus, came up with a point. So we used to call these things alumni, but Trek came up pointed out that actually emeritus in general are actually still pretty active. They're just not doing necessarily the ultra day-to-day activities that people are doing all the time. And so there's like it's not like an alumni in a school where you like went to school and then you stop thinking about it ever again. It's more like an emeritus professor where you're like still around, people can talk to you, you have people respect you, but you're not necessarily required to teach classes anymore.
Core team at large.
Right. So basically, and that actually reflects reality. For example, Makhdi is giving a talk today about Ember concurrency, him becoming an emeritus gave him, like many emeritus professors, time to focus on something that was a passion of his.
You're saying he couldn't do both concurrently?
Mm-hmm. And I think in general, that is sort of our, that is set time out. That's sort of our expectation is like, we don't want to have to wait until someone like completely left the community to notice, oh, you're actually no longer around. But rather like once people start becoming more interested in more focused stuff or generally are not able to do ultra day-to-day activities, then we honor them with emeritus status. So this year, Eric, who was actually like, I think either the first or one of the first contributors to Ember and has always, he's always sort of ran his business through on Ember and talks to a lot of people through trainings and stuff. He always represented the voice of the user. He continues to do that, actually. He is going to be honored with emeritus status. And the flip side of that is that there are three new core team members, Katie Gengler, Chad Haitala, and Ricardo Mendez. You probably know Ricardo Mendez as Lox. So just quickly, Katie does Ember Observer, which means she has somehow superhuman effort read every add-on. and turns out to be a good quality for a core team member, someone who has read every add-on. No, but she's great. She's done really awesome work. Chad has done a huge amount of the heavy lifting behind the scenes on Glimmer for like a very extended period of time.
And he's got the scars to prove it.
It's true. And Lox has also been doing...
Lox is our 24-hour Slack bot.
Exactly.
Who it turns out also is a human.
Yes.
Technology these days is incredible.
Yes. And I would also add that Lox has a strong passion for paper cuts and like just paring down both the learning experience, which he is one of the leaders of that team, and also just in general has focused a lot on trying to reduce paper cuts in Ember. And it's good to have someone focusing on that in general. So that's the new composition of the core team, your core team.
Let's give a round of applause to all these people who work really hard.
So before since we were talking about, like it's been 5 years, I just was doing the nostalgia tour slide deck and reminded myself of what it looked like when we started. So this is the thing people talk about, like, oh, you know, you have these frameworks that were around a long time ago and maybe have some baggage from that time era. I was like, what did it actually look like when we first put code down for Ember 2.0, May 2011, what did the web look like? And it actually was a pretty abysmal place from the perspective of today. Like, nobody actually shipped ES5, let alone ES6. No browser implemented Flexbox. Only a small amount of people implemented like modern features like typed arrays or WebSockets or IndexedDB, and there were features that I think like everyone takes for granted as like obviously that is important, like query selector all, which actually at the time like everyone used Sizzle because or some library like that because the web just was missing core features, and like add event listener, which probably everyone's like, oh, that is obviously an important feature on the web, was not actually standardized at the time. Internet Explorer, which as you can see was the dominant browser, had its own event implementation that you had to use if you wanted to target those browsers. So as you can see, there was it was not a very hospitable place to build stuff, and yet that is the reach upon which we entered.
It's funny, right, because people think, they say offhand the frameworks, like, oh yeah, these frameworks are from an older generation, And yet, at the same time, people today treat IE8 like it's just a bad dream, right? Like it didn't even happen. But and yet, you look at this and like, actually, everything we did had to be in service of IE8 because it was by far the slowest and least capable browser we did, right?
Yes. So I guess we supported IE7 also, but that was at that point already. But yeah, IE8 turned out to not add a lot on top of IE7. But yes, exactly. We were basically forced to do a lot of things in that era just to deal with these very dominant but very, in modern terms, derelict browsers. So in contrast today, like basically all those features have been completed and exist in all web browsers that you target. And there's some new features. So there's some things that you have come, like that you probably know about, like page visibility or media queries that are like really part of the modern toolkit and have already shipped in all browsers. I put border radius and box shadow here because it's just like a thing that at the time was, oh, when can we have border radius?
Yep.
But now like every new web developer does not have to worry about making rounded corner pings that you have to put.
I really enjoy slicing them into.
Pings is not a thing. IE6 did not actually support transparent PNGs, so.
I think you have to add like a dash MS filter to enable that.
Yes, there was some hack. But anyway, that stuff is standard now. It's like part of the toolkit. It's like a whole set of things that you don't have to think about. And there's even like newer features coming, like Service Worker, which lets you intercept network, and WebAssembly, which lets you target very low-level native things. Both Safari and Edge actually have shipped it in technical previews. So like basically WebAssembly is here, more or less. It like already shipped in Chrome and Firefox and is almost here in other browsers. That's like a pretty amazing difference from what the web looked like in 2011 when we started. So it's actually valid to say things have changed, the world should, like web framework should change with those things.
Really incredible, I think, is that there are Ember apps from that era that are on the latest version of Ember today.
Yeah, so like Skylight, the app I work on, we started in 2012 and is on Ember 2.11 or whatever the most recent version of Ember is. We have trains, so I never remember what the latest version of Ember is.
2.37, I think, is the current.
But yeah, like Skylight is on the latest version of Ember, and there's a lot of people like that, and we've been around for a number of years.
I just think when you look at the environment, it's like moving from the Sahara Desert to like a plush luxury apartment. You know what I mean?
Yes.
It's like you've really dramatically changed your environment.
It's only been 5 years, and that's also, by the way, if anybody ever tells you like the web stands still, what has even happened? That's like not true. I don't even have anything to say other than it's just not true. Honestly, 5 years is like a very long time in web time, right? Like, as we have just seen, the world completely shifted. And a lot of times I think about the fact that, like, the Great Recession from 2008 is, like, less than 5 years ago, right? So there's been things that are relatively recent in historical terms that are older than that five-year split. So it's like a lot of web time works at a different speed than regular time. And like another way to think about all this is like here are the points where various things had 1.0 releases. And like one thing that's interesting, so Godfrey wrote this blog post. This image came from a Godfrey blog post from last year. And like some of the things that are on this, I don't even know what they are anymore. Like they have already gone into the sands of time.
That one's called Sprout Core, actually.
That's true. One of those is like Twitter Fabric or something is a thing.
Flight.
I don't know how this is a thing. Anyway, there are various frameworks here, and you can see that even in like framework time, it's pretty long. And so, of course, Ember like started in 2011. We don't still have a string templating engine. Like a lot of things changed over the years, but we were also like pretty early on a lot of the things that we did. So there's actually a lot of areas we were ahead of the curve. In some cases, painfully ahead of the curve. So like for example, we did template compilation ahead of time. Back when it was like still popular to use Mustache and just interpret your like regex, interpret your template. Ember CLI, like when we shipped Ember CLI the first time, it was like many people were like, the web already has a build step. It's called F5. Like,
or the advanced users were like, I have put all my shell scripts inside of a grunt file, so now it is hit.
Right. So it was actually a big thing, and now like basically every framework has a CLI tool, or at least is working on one. When we adopted the 6-week release cycle, basically Chrome and Firefox were the only people who had ever done a 6-week release cycle. So doing it in a library was like a new thing. We also adopted some like ES6 modules, if you were around when we adopted them, were not ready. Like they were still actively being developed when we adopted them. We worked a lot on, of course, people know our rendering engine and things like Fastboot. We worked on not just like there is a way to do it, but it is consistently works throughout the ecosystem with add-ons and everything.
And in fact, the promises A+ spec came out of Dominic's anger at us getting promises wrong.
Yes, that's true.
He's like, listen, you bozos can't get this right, so I will give you a test suite that you can get working.
Yep.
And
so exactly.
Thus arose the promise standard.
Yes. He wrote a blog post that's like, you're doing promises wrong, and it was just like a vitriol at us. And I was like, hey, if you give me a test suite, I'll make it pass. Right, and that ended up being the input into the official promises spec, which is now in the browser. Like, that is the period of time that we're talking. Turns out standards can move quickly sometimes too. So again, it's been like 5 years. That's pretty amazing. I think a lot of the way people talk about this is very abstract. It's like, it's been 5 years, therefore it is time to break things, et cetera. But that's like, it's only possible for people to think about it honestly because there's a lot of people who are new who weren't even around for that entire spectrum, so it's easy to think about it very abstractly, and I tend not to. And interestingly, like a lot of the cool ideas that I talked about in the previous slide are actually like pretty standard. So if the reason that you liked Ember was because we compile our templates ahead of time a few years ago, then you don't need to use Ember anymore. It's fine, everybody does that. Or even if you like Ember because it has a CLI tool, there are a number of frameworks now that are like trying really hard to have a good CLI experience, mm-hmm. right? So there's a lot of reasons that people might have liked Ember a few years ago that by now have become like pretty standard fare.
I think 5 years is enough time for an idea to go from being controversial to basically widely accepted.
Yep. And I would say like most of the things that were most controversial about Ember in the beginning have now become accepted through our evangelism and also people adopting in other frameworks. So that may lead you to ask a question like, is there another 5 years in Ember? Maybe like the Ember's role was to be the bridge between 2011 and 2017, and now we're like done. Everyone should go use something else, like React or whatever. And I think there's a reason why people think that. There's a reason why people feel like it's time to like, you know, Ember is a relic of a bygone era, which is that it seems like there's a lot of baggage in Ember, right? So I think there's some sense in which this is just an abstraction. It's like, oh, it seems like Ember has been around for a long time, therefore obviously there's baggage. And I think on the core team, we're like, actually we did a lot of work to clean up a lot of baggage. There's also some sense, like for example, the Ember object model that is really, really a relic of ES6 classes not existing and ultimately like will make sense to get rid of. And a lot of people, like his initial reaction is that seems like impossible. It's like intrinsically part of Ember, you have to.
Well, even before ES6 classes, I remember Hacker News comments that were like, it looks like Java.
Yes, I agree that people said that. So there's a problem of the innovator's dilemma, basically, which is like, I guess we're not popular enough to have the official version of the innovator's dilemma, although there are 800 people in the room. There is a problem of like, once you have a large number of users, it's actually hard to adapt to changing times because you don't want to hurt the people who are already using your product.
I mean, especially in our community, I think that commitment to stability is actually an important thing, but it comes with important trade-offs, which is that sometimes you have to keep things around longer than you might like to. And so I think it's just natural to ask, well, what's the end game for that?
Yep. And I think we've actually been pretty mindful of this problem and have done a lot to be, like, to mix things up a lot internally throughout the years, but there is still some limit to how far that can take us. So in order to talk about like what's the next 5 years, what are we doing, I want to talk a little bit about things that didn't work or like things that we tried to do that I think just self-evidently ended up failing in terms of the exact projects that we were working on. So like I think we did a survey of the people in this room plus times a few, and one of the top things people said is like, when are you shipping writable components already? Like, it's common. Also, we like tried to deprecate controllers in the 2.0 era and didn't really get over the finish line of that, right? So there's a bunch of things that we did in the 2.0 era that we sort of communicated was a plan, and then I think it's just not controversial to say that by now we didn't really make those plans work. So there's a bunch of things like angle-bracket components, pods, which a lot of people use but don't end up being broadly accessible to most Ember users, that just didn't end up working out for some reason. On the other hand, there's actually been a lot of things that actually did work over the past few years, and I want to talk about those. So Fastboot is a project that allows people to server-side render, these days for SEO purposes, their Ember apps, and that exists, and you can use it today and before today. Engines is a similar story. Engines is a thing that allows you to break up your app into smaller chunks and put them together. So you, instead of having to have one giant Ember app, you can have a few smaller Ember apps that you merge together using engines. And that's also a feature that I would say has been successful in Ember. And of course, Glimmer itself has been very successful. So last year, we said, like, hey, look, we are working on the basic Glimmer 2, which we aren't shipping yet. You can see that we talked about 2.4 at the time. And we actually ended up shipping in 2.10, I think. So like some time went by. But we said, like, at the moment, we're already seeing good performance improvements. And so we said that in March. In July, we announced that the Glimmer 2 alpha, that is like a drop-in replacement for people's apps. And in November, we shipped Glimmer 2 as a drop-in replacement to apps. And basically, right, like, as soon as we shipped it, there's this great blog post that I really liked at the time by Mixonic about, like, what it is to know about Glimmer. And, like, the top thing is, like, it's a drop-in upgrade. But as soon as people started using it, they saw, like, very significant performance improvements, right? So without making any changes to your app, without any breakage for 99.9% of patterns, you got like massively improved performance, and you also got massively reduced bundle sizes. And that's like something that you got between March and November. We shipped a thing that was basically a prototype mode, like already working but not ready to drop in, to something that dropped in and saw big improvements. And like one of the biggest thing that gratified me about this a lot was that this course was actually stuck on pre-Ember 1.13 because of the fact that there were some performance regressions that really impacted their app a lot because they had done some handcrafted optimizations, and also there were legitimate regressions, and they were holding off for improvements, and they, by the time when they actually upgraded to 2.10, they got like double app performance over what they had seen before. So not only were there no more regressions on the 2x branch, they got a 2x improvement from what they saw before. And I think those things are actually significant because of the fact that you didn't have to, there was no breakage, it was just a regular 2.x release. So that's pretty significant. Just in general, that is like the way Ember rolls, is that there are, I think Glimmer 2 was basically a total rewrite of the rendering engine that came after HTML bars, which completely replaced the string-based thing with a DOM-based thing. And we were able to do that in the structure of a normal project. So I think the general frame of like, oh, like things are changing a lot, therefore you're basically forced to like reboot entire projects is not obvious, Drew. I said before there's some limit to how much you can do, but I think the limit is further along than people expect, right? So we're able to switch from a pretty different templating engine to the new one without any changes in the API. And similarly, when we switched to what was then called ES6 modules and is now properly known as ES2015 modules, that was also like we switched from globals mode where people were writing like app dot whatever equals whatever to ES2015, and people were able to use a hybrid, like what we call a hybrid resolver, to migrate incrementally. And these days, like everyone, like Ember is actually one of the earliest adopters of ES2015 modules, so we didn't end up getting left behind in globals mode despite the fact that we started off in globals mode, right? And just in general, I think Ember 2.x as a series has done much better than the very annoying breakage period of Ember 1.13, right? So I'm sort of saying there's a mea culpa here. Like, the Ember 1.13 era tried to do a lot of upfront design, tried to do a lot of things that involve breakage. We ended up not, it wasn't like a total fail because of the fact that we were technically pretty good about deprecations. I think ultimately people wanted the benefits that the 2.x era provided, but there was definitely a bunch of stuff that didn't work so well around the 2.0 era, and I think the 2.x era has worked better in general. So I just basically gave you a juxtaposition between two things, some things I thought went well and some things I thought didn't go well, and like what is my opinion or our opinion about what we learned from those eras. First of all, this is like sad to have to say that we learned this because everyone already knows it, but somehow it's a mistake that even the best of us make. Basically, big upfront design, like trying to design a new feature like angle bracket components or routable components, like something significant, completely before any users are able to access it, and such that it is locked down once you get it out of the gate, right? So if we say here, we have now come down from the mountain with the stone tablets that tell you what routable components are, the chances of that succeeding are actually pretty low. And I think a lot of the 2.0 era mistakes have in common is that we tried a little bit too hard to design things up front. Now, we have a great community, and the RFC process allows people to help participate in that design, but ultimately, design that far precedes usage is not a good design process.
I think we just end up crashing on the rocks of backwards compatibility and our stability guarantees, and so there's this problem, which is that we can't land it until it's something that we feel very confident in, and so in the meantime, it's kind of just sitting around, but no one can use it.
Right, and I think the Ember ecosystem in general has suffered from a lack of experimentation. there are some areas where there's been a lot, and I'll talk about that more later, but there have been some areas where it's just been very difficult because of the fact that we don't expose anything and we're like building towards a glorious future. So I think in general that didn't really, that whole, generally that kind of thing that doesn't work, it didn't work, and you should probably say something if you see it happening again. There's a different approach that has just generally worked a lot better for us over the past year or two, which is instead of like designing a feature like engines up front and like making it perfect and then landing it, or even making like an MVP perfect and landing it, I think Fastboot is a good example of this. What we landed in Ember is just a visit API. All the visit API lets you do is programmatically ask Ember to go visit a URL and give you back the DOM element that came out of that, and then you can do whatever you want with that. So that's all we had to put into Ember, and that's actually not a hard API design. It's low level, most people aren't interacting with it, and it has a reasonably well-bounded design. And then on top of that, we built Fastboot as an external add-on that anybody could use on top of the stable like release builds of Ember. But that thing is allowed to change. Like that thing has its own stability story as it's iterating. And like other people, like LinkedIn actually uses the visit API directly without even using Fastboot.
Yep. And people could plug in their own server infrastructure on top. And I think the point with server-side rendering with client-side apps is it is a brand new thing and we're all learning how best to do it. And if you think that you have a better way of doing it, you shouldn't feel like...
stymied.
You shouldn't feel stymied because Fastboot isn't moving fast enough or it uses Express and you're really like a very happy user. You can do it now, right? You have the tools, you have the same underlying primitive that we have.
So in general, like both the Engine API and the Fastboot API were things where we figured out what small things we need to add to Ember to allow experimentation to happen elsewhere. We also aren't just like throwing you to the wolves and saying do the whole thing yourself. We're giving a pretty good initial reference implementation that probably eventually will get merged in some form. But we're also totally fine and happy to have people try other stuff. And in fact, in both cases, people have done that. So I think that's sort of the new way that we're thinking about approaching design in Ember. However, when we actually add new features to Ember, like Glimmer, it is important that those features not create forks. So even if technically you can have a compatibility story like you opt into Glimmer and then you are like forking the universe and you have a completely different rendering engine or something like that, it's actually important to us that when things get added to Ember, like Ember proper, that Stack Overflow, that documentation, whatever, reflect a mainline way to do stuff. So when we're doing a big internal refactor like Glimmer, Glimmer 1 actually just suffered from there wasn't a good enough compatibility story. And I think from now on, whenever we make big internal refactors, we're not gonna make big breaking changes anymore. So I think the summary is like experimentation is a key way that we all evolve as an ecosystem. So there are things like, I should be clear by the way, this smiley face and frowny face is not a passing judgment about the project, it's about how many hoops the author of that project had to jump through to get their job done. So Ember Redux and is built on top of basically the object model story in Ember. Of course, it doesn't use the Ember object model, but the fact that the shim between POJOs and the template layer is well-defined in Ember means that it's not very hard to implement Ember Redux. Ember Concurrency, Ember Orbit Ember Orbit is built on top of the same shim that Ember Data uses, right? So basically those three things use fairly well-defined APIs that exist already in Ember that you can use to experiment. Godfrey actually gave a really good talk the first EmberConf about experimenting with those things. He built a Hacker News reader that used like HTML as a data source and things like that. So there are some APIs that are actually great and have allowed a lot of experimentation. But then there's other things like the component API, which is quite locked down, and that means that people who are implementing innovative things in the component space end up getting, have to use private APIs that break, and means the experimentation is not so stable. So really what we learned from the last couple of years since 2.0 is experimentation is very important. We don't want to break back to compatibility willy-nilly, but we need to do more to expose the primitives that make the system work so that people can try other things and don't lean so much on doing everything up front. So some things that are actively happening along these lines are angle bracket components, which is a thing that you probably have heard of at various points and like want for good reasons. We'll talk about more also later. Is a feature that kind of suffered from the fact that we had a one-shot chance to replace the existing component model with a new component model, so let's like get it perfect before we ship anything. And even though we were like always targeting an MVP, there's just so many questions about how you want to model it that meant that it was very difficult for us to ship anything. And that's roughly what happened. So you should check out Godfrey's RFC, which I have a link to later on in the presentation, but there's a picture of it here, if you want to look very closely. Binoculars. But basically, the way we're doing angle bracket components is that we're implementing a low-level custom component API that is, it's not like it's a function, have a nice day. It's basically like sufficiently rationalized to talk about most of the things that Ember components already know how to do, like lifecycle hooks and things like that, and templates. But it's low level, so you can implement lightweight components and ideally angle bracket components as well. So the idea is that we're gonna start doing the same story. We design a primitive, the primitive has less ergonomic pressure on it, and then we let ourselves and other people do experimentation outside of core. And then another thing you probably have heard of, there's a new version of pods called, which is sometimes called module unification, which is just whatever the technical name for it is in the RFC. But basically, it's a way of allowing you to put components next to the other, next to the components that are nested into, helpers next to the components that use them, components inside the routes that use them. That feature used to be called pods. That also went through a pretty low-level RFC and is now, it's going to become available through an add-on that allows you to have have both worlds in the same thing. I wanted to have a slide with the two lines of the code you need to write to make that work today, but Robert knows. You can tweet at Robert, and he will probably reply to all of you. But basically, it's the same story, right? We don't want to have to make everyone wait for the feature to get the high-level feature into the framework. So we're trying to expose more hooks that let people do experiments, but also we're doing a lot of the work, just in a way that doesn't put as much pressure on stability right away. So with that said, probably the biggest thing along these lines, the biggest active work item is Glimmer 2, and I want to talk about that today because it's an active work item and I'm excited and probably so are you, hopefully. So I want to give a tiny recap of what caused Glimmer 2 to exist in the first place, and I think it's easier to understand the story based on what I already just said about what was going right and wrong. So I think we only really did the postmortem now about 2.0, but I think we started throughout the last year thinking more about the exact problem of primitives and modularity. So when we started working on Glimmer, what we noticed, and we talked about this last year, is that the boundary between Ember and the templating layer was actually not very crisp. So there was a lot of things that just ended up on one side or the other for no apparent reason. And that the real consequence of that is that Ember itself ended up pulling in a lot of random view layer templating engine concerns just because of that's where it happened to land in the world. And so the exact boundary between Ember and HTML bars was very was not very clear, which meant you couldn't take HTML bars and use it in another project very easily. So the Glimmer project was really about extracting the things that were generic, like yield, for example, in a template is actually a very generic concept, and extracting that out of Ember and putting it into a separate library, and really leaving Ember's job to be high-level Ember features and compatibility, right? So there are some features like outlets and last year the component helper, although now that is actually extracted into Glimmer. But basically any features that are pretty coupled to how Ember tends to work, exactly how Ember's object model interacts with Glimmer, those things are in Ember. But Glimmer itself is now a really general purpose rendering engine. And importantly, because that is a very large magnitude shift, right? That is a significant internal change. I think in practice every single line of code in Ember that had to do with the view layer in the last 2 years has been replaced at some point.
Probably three times.
Probably a few times in some cases. So in order to buffer the people in this room from those changes, but also give you the benefits, the Ember layer is basically the thing that gave you a consistent API. So that ends up being very important, right? I've said this a few times, but making 2.10 a drop replacement for 2.9 is a significantly better story than 1.13 not being a drop-in replacement from 1.12. I think that's obvious, but I think for people who are here for both, the story was very different. Even though I would actually say that 1.13 is closer to 1.12's implementation than 2.10's implementation is to 2.9. We just worked a lot harder on compatibility because of how much the breakage didn't really work out. It caused more problems than we expected. I know it all sounds very silly in retrospect, but. And I would also say that tests, one of the things that made this work is that when we did 2.10, when we did Glimmer, we made sure that the testing suite ran on both the old engine and the new engine. Unfortunately, as you probably know from having written tests, there are plenty of tests in the world that are accidentally coupled to implementation details that are not part of the public API. So we did a huge effort that the community, probably a lot of people in this room, helped with, which was just to take tests that were accidentally coupled to some implementation detail and upgrade them to be more general so that when we say, you know, how does an if statement work, it really is testing how an if statement works and not some detail of how the view layer used to work, like the view system in Ember 1.0. So the community really helped with this. I think it would actually have been impossible to ship Glimmer if we didn't get a lot of help from the community on upgrading the tests. And it was not a trivial automatable job. There was a lot of detail work in it. The community helped a lot, and I basically want to give everyone a round of applause for helping with that, because you couldn't have done any of this without that help. And I just want to say, like, bluntly, like, from now on, this is the process that we use for engines, for Fastboot, for Glimmer, is how we're doing it from now on. We're going to not lean on breaking changes. We're going to not lean on big upfront design, and we're instead going to lean on small primitives and compatibility as our main mantra for how we do new feature design. So just to give people an update on what's been going on since we've been talking about Glimmer, I want to talk again about how the Glimmer VM works. Just because it gives you some context. So first of all, the general problem that Glimmer is trying to solve, you don't need to read all the text on the slide. The general problem that Glimmer is trying to solve is that there's actually two problems in web application design that are in conflict with each other. So there's like 60 FPS jank, or like if someone wants to be fancy, like main thread stall. I sometimes see this on Twitter. That is one problem, like you're trying to be very interactive to users once your app is going. And then there's another problem, which is like, how fast can I get my app going in the first place? Or what is the time to first interactivity, or sometimes called boot time, that also is very important. People care a lot on the web about it. And both of those actually are, in like computer science terms, real-time constraints, right? And if you are building a financial transaction system, you have a real-time constraint, you need to respond very quickly, but you are willing to spend like infinite time on boot up to get to very, very fast responsive time once you're running. So many of the people who already have done a lot of research on how to make very fast responsiveness, like the 60 FPS constraint, don't actually care about initial render time. A good example of this is games, right? Every game in the world has a loading spinner that sometimes takes a very long time because they have decided because it's very important that we get fast interactivity, we are willing to spend some large amount of time doing setup work. On the web, we simply cannot do that. So we have a really hard constraint of how do we make initial render time fast and also make interactivity after that fast, which is just a somewhat unexplored problem and the web forces us into. And in general, like, a worse problem is that computer science used to have this memory versus speed trade-off, people might have heard of, in like the 60s, 70s, whatever. And at some point people decided, oh, there's like plenty of memory, so you can always just do the work up front. But it turns out doing work up front also takes time, right? So it's not just a memory constraint, which we have plenty of now, we have gigabytes of memory. It's also how long it takes to actually do that work. So the web sort of changed how people are thinking about optimizations in general, which means a lot of the ways people generally have thought about it so far are not directly applicable. There are some questions that we need to resolve. So I would say that's the framing that I personally use for what is the point of Glimmer, like trying to deal with this trade-off. So basically, the web has a special problem, which is we are required to boot up in very absurdly fast time, like people's, like under 1 second you have to boot up, and also you have to be 60 FPS once you boot it. Like somehow, like I find it ironic that basically it's like the most beginner-friendly environment in the world, and it's like the hardest computer science problem in the world. something has to give here. And like I think one thing that's interesting that you probably have noticed is that you can go really fast if you don't worry about updating, right? So if you don't care about updating, then you can do a very naive thing like either just use HTML or just run a very fast series of DOM operations, and then that is the fastest. So it's actually impossible. Like it's basically impossible for any framework, be it like Inferno or Vue.js or Ember, to beat Vanilla.js, because Vanilla.js just doesn't care about updating. And so what everyone is trying to figure out, like every framework, is how can we have our cake and eat it too? How can we get the initial render time down to a relatively low amount without sacrificing updating performance? And actually, Ember had a very extreme version of this problem, because when React came out, they basically said, we're gonna put updating performance aside for a minute, and some of the original talks about React that talked about Ember basically said Ember has very fast updating time, but unfortunately that updating time comes at a cost. It's too expensive to render initially, and we have actually come up with a system that has a better trade-off. And I agree, actually, the React system had a better trade-off. However, we could, because of the fact that we already have a lot of users with big apps, we actually couldn't regress on updating performance. So we had to figure out how to create a system that was much faster at initial render, but also roughly the same speed at updating. And that just made it hard, like made the problem very hard and forced us into pretty creative problem solving mode when we worked on Glimmer. So last year, we talked about Glimmer and we said, like, we are getting like 1.5 to 2x performance speed boosts in component-heavy scenarios, we said last year. I think that particular benchmark was actually very focused on component-heavy scenarios. Real apps, of course, are a mix. The good news is that when we actually landed Glimmer, we got roughly that. We got somewhere between 1.5 and 2x on, like, the whole app, people's whole apps. And that's actually pretty cool. I think, like, it's hard to ever find ways to make things twice as fast that without compatibility issues. And we actually got both speed and size. So like Robin Ward here, who works on Discord, says, I can't think of a release of a library or framework that reduced my app size and significantly improved performance. Ember 2.10 is super rare. So, and all these tweets are basically saying that. Like, honestly, I was actually pretty scared because you can never know when you ship something and what the impact is. But like, uniformly, people upgraded to 2.10 and got very significant boosts. So the fact that we did that and it was compatible is pretty good. And again, what I would say is, we were basically forced into doing this because of the fact that we already have very good updating performance in the beginning. And I want to talk a little bit about the architecture before handing it off to Tom to talk about fun stuff in a bit. So there's a few wins. Like, now that we know that Glimmer is faster, we can talk a little more, I can talk more confidently about what parts of the architecture make it faster and smaller. So first of all, the way Ember used to work is that we would compile templates to JavaScript, which can be large. Some frameworks have very large output. We had medium size, but still pretty large output. And one of the big changes that we made in Glimmer was that we have a wire format that's intentionally designed to be compact. So the wire format tries to do as much work as possible in the pre-compilation phase. It is importantly not executable JavaScript, which means that all of your templates do not have to run in a, like the VM doesn't have to run them. It's just the way we get them is JSON.parse, which is much faster than executing JavaScript. And also does not introduce like laziness considerations or other things that cause slowness. We also really want to use this to reduce in-browser work, right? We want to take as much as possible anything that we know ahead of time, like this is a local variable or whatever, and move it into the wire format. And in general, one thing that has been true about Glimmer the whole time is that we want to take advantage of the declarative nature of our templating syntax, right? Our templating syntax has always had the cost of not allowing you to just put random JavaScript expressions in there, but has had the benefit of therefore being very upgradable to different architectures. So the more we can take advantage of things that are latent in the syntax, the better we can do at performance. So that's wire format. That basically is just how people are like, my app is twice as, like my whole app bundle is twice as small. That's how we did that. Now, there's another pretty major optimization that we do that allows us to beat other rendering engines, and that's the static content optimization. We talked about it last year. I just want to show it. We're running out of time, but hopefully it will be okay. It's fine. So here's a template that has a div and a span and some dynamic content in it. That's the wire format. And what actually happens in practice is that we compile to what is a bytecode, and I'm just using assembly notation here for convenience, but you can't write this anywhere. There's no assembly or compiler. But it looks like roughly like this. We basically take the template and we compile it into a series of small opcodes. And the important thing here is that the append pass, you can see, has like two open calls, two closed calls, whatever. And the updating pass does not. The updating pass has a single revalidate of that curly. This is actually more or less, this is a textual representation of more or less how it actually works. Someone asked me the other day on Twitter, is it an analogy or is it actually a bytecode VM? It is actually a bytecode VM. And the important thing is there's only one opcode out of the set on top that has any possibility of updating, right? So an open div cannot, by definition, cannot be updated because it's like open a div. There's no dynamic thing in there, so there's nothing to update. Whereas the call thing, technically one of the parameters to call could change, so you have to do some work to update it. So we have a good system that allows us to both rationalize what we're doing in terms of a bytecode VM and then also extract from the initial render just a small amount of things that we have to do to update. I want to talk about performance because I've been talking about it a lot without saying anything, and I just want to briefly show some benchmarks, but I want to mega caveat them, perhaps more than you may have usually had caveats. Benchmarks are not just sometimes obtuse or not giving you good information. Sometimes they're actively misleading, and I think in practice they are usually actively misleading for various reasons. This is a really good blog post by Benedict Muir on the VA team about how they basically spent multiple years working on optimizations that made their benchmarks faster, that made the web slower. Like, legitimately slower, like made Ember slower by several times, allowed JSC to outperform them by sometimes like 5x because they were chasing the wrong benchmarks. So it's not just that like benchmarks might be not telling you a lot, sometimes they are actually sending you down, usually they are sending you down bad paths. So I don't actually like the benchmarks that people use for web performance, for web framework performance. However, that is what people use to figure out if you're fast, so I have decided to run them for Glimmer, but please do not take away anything specific out of these benchmarks because I do not want to have to optimize for these particular benchmarks because they are not realistic. So here's like initial render. This is actually the case. So there, I said micro benchmark here because these benchmarks are basically they're rendering one thing. They're rendering like a piece of dynamic content with no HTML. So in the real world, of course, you have HTML because you have CSS, so you need to make your HTML do something. In the micro benchmarks that people test that you have seen online, usually there's like one piece of dynamic content that's being rendered, and that's fine, but it's not even remotely a real world scenario. So our initial render is a little like in the ballpark of the fast rendering engines, it's a little slower. Our updating side is just always like reliably faster than our competitors on the Glimmer VM, just because of the static optimization. It's like no matter what, it's always faster, basically. And we updated the benchmark that you probably have seen online that we're doing here with more realistic content, which is basically just like take some bootstrap HTML that is needed to generate an icon and put it into the content because that probably needs to exist in people's real apps. And if you put some content into the HTML and rerun the benchmarks, you will find that the results are quite different. Inferno is still very fast, but we're still like now we're like very competitive and we're still in the same ballpark, right? I think updating is probably the most like more interesting, which is that when you start adding static content, you can understand why based on my previous slides, when you start adding static content, we end up doing really well. So in real apps, you just end up with a lot of content that is not happened to be bound for some reason. And Glimmer is extremely good at that because we do exactly zero work on the updating pass for that piece of content. And so in the real world, that content exists and we end up beating even the most optimized React work-alikes because of the fact that they end up having to do some work for the static content. Even if they manage to get that work to be relatively cheap, they have to do some work. So basically we're doing very well now that we have a thing that is running real content and is shipped, we can look at how our VM performance is and understand it. So this is basically just a benchmark we did last year. I just figured I would show it again. It's basically, the point of this benchmark, if for people who weren't here last year, is every box is a component in this benchmark. So our old system was bad at rendering components. So if you added a lot of components, it made things slow. And now we take, like, components have to be fast as a hard constraint. So there's a lot of them on this demo. You actually have to scroll to see all the things that are on here. So it's fast. So in general, the TLDR is what we're trying to accomplish is to get into the sweet spot of initial render and updating performance so that we can continue to have very good updating without you having to think a lot about things like should component update, but also get initial render fast. So one last thing before fun stuff. So components are probably still an area where we could do better. And so here's an example of a component that's in the Glimmer VM. This is what a component looks like. And this is what the wire format looks like. And here is what the assembler looks like right now for that component. And if you look at this, you'll see that there's actually a number of things in the component assembler that basically are Ember semantics. So things like you actually have a component class and it has some properties on it is actually a semantic that might not always be needed. Or maybe in this case there are no blocks, so why are we pushing them onto the stack? Or things like parent view and child views might not always be needed, so why are we supporting them? So there's a lot of, we have made these operations very cheap, but there's a lot of things that intrinsically are not needed to make the component model in Glimmer work. And so there's a thing that we have been working on in the architecture, which is basically to allow you to remove those opcodes. And Godfrey's RFC is actually about this. Godfrey's RFC is about allowing people who are not allow things that are not the Ember components to still exist in Ember. I know, Crystal. Allow things that are not in Ember to expressly opt out of features that they don't need, to eliminate some of the opcodes.
Thank you, Yehuda. So, I don't know if you all know this, but the way that Yehuda and I get ready for keynotes is we just put old Steve Jobs videos on loop to a combo of Chariots of Fire, Eye of the Tiger. which you can probably tell. So when Steve Jobs came back to Apple in like 1998, after they purchased Next, Apple was in a very bad place, and as a Mac user at the time, so were Macs. And Steve Jobs gave this talk that I thought was really good, where he took Maslow's hierarchy of needs and adapted it to the Apple hierarchy of skepticism. Because you remember at the time, every article in the press, whether it was the tech press or the general press, was every single one used the word beleaguered. I don't know if you guys remember that, but there was a point where every article about Apple was how beleaguered they were. And so Steve Jobs gave this talk, and he said, you know, I used to get really frustrated that every time we would solve one of these problems about the Mac or about Apple as a company, it seemed like they were just moving the goalpost. Now, there's another thing that they had to overcome, some other objection. He said, I used to get really frustrated by this. He says, but now I actually appreciate it. Now I understand that when the objection changes, it means that I have convinced them that the past thing has been fixed, right? So actually, it means you're succeeding. It actually means you're succeeding. And so I would like to introduce you to the Ember hierarchy of skepticism. So if we start at the bottom, right, there were all these reasons people had for not wanting to use Ember. The first one was like the build tooling was really bad, didn't come with any build tooling, it was hard to use. We got dinged for not having any documentation, basically. Yehuda showed you the example that was like mega outdated, and that was in 1.10. Bind adder and metamorph just bloating up the DOM. And so these are all things that we have heard, we've got that feedback, and now we've convinced people that these are no longer problems. But there are some that still remain. So for example, one thing that people complain a lot about when they look at an Ember app is it doesn't look like JavaScript, it looks like this weird Java thing with our custom class system, right? And so Matthew Beal and Tom, I apologize Tom, I forgot your last name, just because your first name is so good that I... So 201 Created have, as probably many of you know, every year do this community survey, and we get some really fantastic feedback. People are sometimes brutally honest, but it really helps keep us honest. And so what people say, largely, is that they really wish that Ember could integrate better with the rest of the module ecosystem. They don't like the fact that Ember is this monolithic build. They don't like the fact that it feels like you're leaving JavaScript and going into this foreign environment. And of course, we oftentimes get dinged on size and speed. So
on the other hand, like people are usual, like those were some cherry-picked, most negative people, mm-hmm. but most of the feedback is generally positive, and people say that they feel very productive using Ember, or they feel like Ember, they feel like they will say positive things about Ember CLI, right? So there's, right. Most people have a lot of things that they like about Ember, the opinionated nature, convention of a configuration, but there is definitely, even people, this example, even someone who was generally happy has some of the same concerns that some of our biggest detractors have.
So I am really excited to share with you all something that we've been working really hard on, which is Glimmer. And I think if you take that hierarchy of skepticism that people have about Ember, all the reasons they say that they don't want to use Ember, I think we knock out almost all of them. So the first thing people say is they don't like, you guys, you've all dealt with this, tag name, attribute bindings. All you want is a component like that's an input field, and you have to write all of this JavaScript with this weird syntax that you have to learn just to have an input tag with some attributes,
and
right?
This is not, unfortunately, me trolling us, it's the reality.
Yes.
As I'm sure many people know.
So in Glimmer, you can express everything about the root element of a component all in your template. It's like an outer HTML instead of an inner HTML.
So this is an, this is like another, sorry, keep going.
So the point here is that you can bind dynamic content from your component to your template without having to learn these esoteric invocations of the component.
And the component syntax is just JavaScript, right? That's, like, you can see, so of course you can get, there are a lot of cases now where you can get away with not having any JavaScript class at all because you just have some HTML in the outer HTML and all you were doing was writing attribute bindings. But there are still some cases where you need a component, a lot of cases, and the syntax for that is a JavaScript class, ES6 class. Yes.
And of course, one thing that people ask us all the time, I want to be able to use TypeScript with Ember. Well, with Glimmer, it's written in TypeScript, so of course, it's super easy to use, and you get awesome autocomplete, IntelliSense, inline code documentation, inline documentation, the whole bit. And of course, computed properties. People always say, why can't I just use accessors? Well, now you can. And why do I have to put .computed on the end of all of my properties? Well, you don't have to do .computed anymore. You don't have to have these weird Ember syntaxes. Now you can just use decorators, which is a stage 2 feature in TC39. And these, of course, pair very well together, so you get really nice functionality so you can annotate your fields and get type checking as you're typing your code, which is really, really nice. Actions in your template are no longer some weird Ember thing. The action helper just takes those functions and binds them, and you can install it as a click on onClick helper, for example, inside of an element. And just it's just a regular function with arguments that get curried. And probably the biggest one, people hate get and set. With the JavaScript accessors, with Glimmer, you don't need these anymore. So how many of you saw that article that was going around about the size of the output from Hello World apps from different CLI tools? Okay, you see, y'all see this?
I'm glad not many people saw it.
So this test was, I go to the website for this framework or this library, I get the recommended CLI tool, I install it, I do a production build, I check the size. So you can see that Ember is not what we would call in the same ballpark as the others, it's significantly larger. And this file size, unfortunately, makes many people consider Ember to be disqualified. And I think what's really exciting to me is that the output of a Hello World app from Glimmer is just about 30K. So that is less even than Vue. And the only other library beating us right now is Preact. And I think they can have that. So that's me. I just want to share with you a video that Ryan and Sam from EmberMap have created. And this is just going to show you what the experience of writing a Glimmer app is like. And I think you're really going to enjoy it. I'm Tom Dale. And today, I want to show you Glimmer.js. Glimmer is a new JavaScript component library that helps you build rich, dynamic user interfaces for the web. Extracted from Ember's battle-tested rendering layer, Glimmer is fast enough to be used on the mobile web, so simple that you can learn the basics in just a few minutes. Let me show you how it works. To get started, we'll first install Ember CLI. Glimmer uses Ember CLI to help you get up and running without any setup or configuration. We can create our first Glimmer app by using Ember New with the Glimmer Blueprint. Ember CLI has generated an app directory for us. If we open it up, we'll find that our new project has been scaffolded and is ready to go. Glimmer components are made up of templates and JavaScript files. Let's start by making our first component called Weather Tracker. Glimmer templates are built on HTML, so let's paste in some existing code. We actually now have our first working Glimmer component. Let's try it out by opening the app template, adding our Weather Tracker component, and starting the Ember server. If we open the app in a browser, we can see that our Weather Tracker component is being rendered. Glimmer makes it easy to build data-driven components. Our Weather Tracker currently has a temperature hard-coded in its template. Let's replace that with some JavaScript data. We'll open our component file and define an object called Weather that has a temperature property.
We can now display this data in our template using a familiar handlebars-like syntax. And just like that, our component's output is being rendered from local data. Now, our component would be a lot more useful if it was displaying current live data from the server, so let's implement that now. To start, we'll use the tracked decorator to tell Glimmer that data within our weather object can now change. We've just made our component reactive. It will now intelligently re-render whenever the weather property changes. Next, let's write a function that requests the latest data from an API. Because Glimmer comes with TypeScript out of the box, we can write this asynchronous function using async and await. We'll start by writing an async function called loadWeather. We'll request data from the server, and then set our weather property to the resulting JSON object. Finally, we'll kick off this function in our component's constructor, so it runs whenever our component is used. And we can see that our component is now rendering data from the server. Let's update our loadWeather function to pull every 2 seconds. Our data is now changing, and Glimmer is keeping our templates in sync. Now, you may have heard that Glimmer is one of the fastest JavaScript rendering engines, and while our weather tracker is pretty simple, Glimmer maintains that performance even under significantly more load. But how does that work? First, Glimmer compiles your templates down into a compact series of instructions known as bytecode. Besides being small in size, these instructions are extremely efficient. Since all of your tracked variables are known ahead of time, Glimmer is able to avoid unnecessary re-renders of your application without any optimization effort from you. When your app boots up on the client, Glimmer's virtual machine reads in your template bytecode and produces a streamlined program to render your data-driven application. This novel approach is what makes Glimmer one of the fastest JavaScript rendering engines, while also being one of the smallest. Glimmer embraces all of the patterns of composition that you've come to expect from a modern component library. For example, we can pass arguments into components. Right now, our weather tracker only shows the weather for New York. Let's update it to take in a zip code as an argument. First, we'll add a second weather tracker to our application, and we'll pass in a zip code for San Francisco. Glimmer uses the at symbol to distinguish between JavaScript data that we pass to our components and normal HTML attributes like class. Now in our component, we can use that new zip argument in our loadWeather function. And now we can see the weather for San Francisco shows up. In this video, we've touched on just some of the features that Glimmer gives you for building rich JavaScript components. And when you're ready to ship, Ember CLI provides an easy way to distribute those components to existing web applications. The ember build command gives you a script that you can drop into any JavaScript or server-rendered web app. That script exports your Glimmer components as web components, meaning you can use them in your apps just like you would any other native HTML element. Glimmer's rendering engine and powerful composition story, bundled with cutting-edge features like TypeScript support, ES6 classes, and an opinionated file system, make it a joy to work with. We took the same technology that powers Ember and made it simple, small, and lightning fast. And I'm so excited to finally get to share it with you. So go try it out and build something awesome.
All right, and then next I just wanted to play this candy pickle chili video for you, which is the sequel. Okay, we're like mega over time here.
So I think, first of all, that was not a mock-up that exists in the world. You should use it.
You can go to glimmerjs.com and install it now.
Yep. But we should probably talk about how this connects to Ember, since this is EmberConf, and also probably you would not want us to announce that we are abandoning Ember, which we are not. So you may be curious to hear how it is connected. So first of all, this is the component API we want for Ember. So I talked a lot before about the fact that we're modeling more of how Ember works so that we can do experimentation outside of Ember. This is an example of that, right? We really want Ember's primitives to be able to allow the Glimmer API library to work on top of Ember. We ultimately want something like the Glimmer API to be the Ember API, and we need to get there. And so Godfrey's RFC number 213 is basically the primitive that we need to allow people to allow you to write Glimmer, the Glimmer add-ons, the Glimmer API as an add-on. And that's the plan for how you can use the component API in Ember soon. There's also, you saw in the video, an improved directory structure. If people have been following along, you probably know that there is the module unification feature is basically the improved directory structure for Ember. It has been a large process. Glimmer is the first project that uses it natively, but there is already an add-on that you can install in Ember now that uses the low-level resolver API to allow you to do a hybrid of the Glimmer directory structure and the Ember directory structure. As I said before, the TLDR of that is that you can put components and helpers, et cetera, alongside the place where they belong, co-located with where they belong. The only opt-in that you'll need is to change the app directory to the source directory and install the add-on. There's a bigger project of like how we migrate people, so there's a migrator project that you can run to migrate your app, but we also expect that people will end up having both the app directory and the source directory for some period of time while they migrate, but that's also something that is already happening in Ember. Probably if you've been following along, you recognize some of these details.
The point is that module unification links right now the Ember and the Glimmer worlds. So our goal is that very soon you would be able to take your components from a Glimmer app, drag and drop them into an Ember app, and it would just work.
And would get the same performance that you would expect from the Glimmer app. TypeScript is also a thing that is easier for us to do in Glimmer because of the fact that we, of course, wrote it in TypeScript, so it's very easy for TypeScript apps to consume TypeScript libraries. There's another thing we have been working on with the TypeScript team for the past probably year, which is to enhance the TypeScript language enough to support some of the more dynamic features in Ember, and they announced in both 2.2 and 2.3 some new features. And the cool thing about this, so this is an example that we worked on together with the project manager at TypeScript, and the cool thing about this demo is that it's using ember.object.extend, like it's using a subclass of ember.object.extend, and it's using get, and the get string literal is code completing, right? So basically TypeScript is quite powerful now, and a lot of that power was in order to allow us to support TypeScript in Ember. It actually works with just JavaScript files. I actually noticed this like inadvertently the other day. I made a new Ember app and went into it and typed const computed equals ember.computed and then typed computed.lte and I got type signature and I was like, how is that possible? The way it's possible is that VS Code now has automatic type acquisition that will download the type files for you, which somebody else wrote, and it gets the right thing. So this demo here is using an updated version of that DTS. So you get some of the benefits like this code completion example without, you can see there are no types in this file, there are no mandatory types in this file, and it could be just a JS file and you still get a lot of the benefits, but of course we want you to be able to use TS files also. So the thing is, we really like TypeScript. I think in general we don't ever want to build features that mandate that you use TypeScript. We never want to force anybody to use TypeScript. We never want to make it a core requirement of the semantics, but we really do want using TypeScript to be a pleasant experience, I think because a lot of us have come to really like it building Glimmer. And that is a, this is what happens when you make slides on the web. So the idea basically, Glimmer is basically designed for today, if you want to use Glimmer. It's designed for building small mobile applications, which were not a good fit for Ember before. I think nobody would claim otherwise. And Ember is still really what you use to build big ambitious applications. It has a CLI tool, it has a router, it has add-ons. Things that you might need if you're building a bigger application. But it's probably important that you not have to constantly pick and choose between just using Glimmer or just using whole Ember. There should be a spectrum in between. We don't currently have anything yet, but the plan that we are really, really web.
Beautiful.
Very gorgeous. The plan that we have here is basically that we are gonna repeat the process of extracting Glimmer out from Ember. And maybe rewrite slides.com in Ember. We're gonna repeat the process of extracting pieces of Ember out, like the router, like Ember data, so that they're more rationalized as standalone components. And the ultimate idea is that you can NPM install your way to Ember, right? Start from Glimmer, and then NPM install your way up. So that process of getting to that vision requires that we do that a piece at a time, right? We start with Glimmer, and then we say, you know, what's the next thing? Maybe the next, we already did it for the DI system, the container system. Maybe the next thing is the router. There's various, this is a community project, so we will basically totally be based on what ends up getting pulled from the community, but there's more work that can be done along these lines, and I think ultimately, starting with the thing that is 30K and adding things as needed up to Ember is good. People have asked for tree shaking, by the way, and I think that's a, like, we, like, Glimmer application does tree shaking with rollup out of the box, but ultimately, like, human beings need to understand what they're opting into and not be reliant on extremely magic optimizations that could fail at any time. So I think thinking about, oh, I actually need a router, therefore I will add it to my project is a good thing to be able to do, even if we were somehow able to magically make it optimized. So anyway, the TLDR is, the ultimate vision here is that Ember is still, the end game for Ember is it will be faster and more, generally more rationalized, but it has the feature set that you expect today, and Glimmer is designed for small mobile apps, and then if you, as you, in between, you opt into packages that were extracted from Ember. So, that's it.
Thank you.